Okay, welcome to this talk on Ethereum governance. My name is Shiv Malik. I now officially evangelize for StreamR. I was also an investigative journalist for 10 years, including for The Guardian and for the panel. So it's with that hat on that I will now share a few stories, lessons in what it means to build up against power. So this talk is entitled In Defense of Nick Szabo's. There's this phrase in Britain which we have, it goes, play the ball and not the man. So I'm going to not try the ball, but personally, he's here. We've had a few times, and it's pretty lovely. So I will play the ball, but Vlad, you sort of made things personal by having time yourself personally to the arguments you put forward. More lucid, and constructed, not running to tweet number 192 in the 3-month-long thread on Twitter, goes something a bit like this. Nick Szabo's law, or the principle that code is law, needs to be dispensed with. We, Ethereum, have a messiah and the Ethereum community. Does this one need to be legal? Is code, is law, just, is it working? Really, what we have is, to quote, but actually, he says nothing that we do in the Ethereum community is above, beyond, or outside the rule that he states as a threat. That said, he's going to die on this hill of confirming that Szabo's law is the ultimate threat to Ethereum. But in short, we find the whole argument of the worst kind. What Vlad is putting forward is incredibly dangerous, even Vlad, I'm sorry to say, it's time to die on that hill. So enough preamble, we should make some bricks on this deck like that, sorry. Anyway, enough preamble, I'll start with this pleasant story. Just over a decade ago, when I was a freelance journalist, three police officers from the Greater Manchester Police Terrorism Unit came looking at my door. When I asked why they showed up at this flat, they told me this. We're here to talk to you about a book. We're here to talk to you about a book. The writing, I was indeed writing a book. They were mistaken. Those words just aren't the kind of thing you'd expect to hear in a democracy where the writing of books should not be the concern. After I let them in, they served me with a draft order instructing me to give them all of my source materials. Recordings, notes, transcripts, pretty much everything I'd created in the course of my reporting on terrorism for years. Of course, journalists don't give up their sources, they protect them. I don't hand over notes and recordings unless the police order is to do so. So I thought they would. And a few months later, I found myself sitting before three of the most senior judges in the UK listening to their verdict. Came to modify the scope of that order. In the end, they agreed with the Manchester Police, who chatted about my friend. And in that moment, I came face to face with the realization that I didn't want to do what these three judges ordered me to do. And my precious belongings and my journalistic credibility over to the police, I would likely have got them in jail. The period of hearing out Russian debate had ended, and even though I'd committed no crime or caused any civil injury, I could be forced against my will to do what the representatives of the state wanted me to do. I was simply put. They had the right to put me in prison. It came up against the law that is the state's monopoly of my rights.
So, on the maximum number of cops that
I've been because they didn't want to go to jail. Another example I wrote, actually a very early draft of this talk, from a hotel in Istanbul, Turkey, where it turns out searching for the term monopoly on violence is actually
It's actually truly peer-to-peer, so Visa or Zwei.
So I discovered this because after trying a few times and receiving an error to about page, the hotel manager suddenly appears at my breakfast table and presents me with this cartoon from The Economist about freedom of speech.
And she sends the book.
See, this is a full cartoon. She's laughing nervously. She's so nervous for me. She's laughing nervously. And I quickly realize what she means.
What I'm
doing with the words that put she and I don't get ourselves into serious trouble.
But actually, in my opinion,
of course, there are benefits to states having a monopoly on violence. Afghanistan and Somalia are the nicest examples of what happens when there is no such monopoly. Hobbes' right existence becomes nasty, brutish, and short. But in the modern era, downsides are also really.
Oh, what I can also mention is that Charles' parable for
Hobbes
as well.
So far,
if you're an international provider of many
In short, if you want to achieve serious change and you aren't willing to be fined, go to jail, be killed, or negotiate or renegotiate the monopoly through taking arms yourself, and how many political movements from the suffragettes to the US civil rights movement, ending independence to the struggle against apartheid have done just this. Have a good, righteous music.
And that confirms all of this transaction.
So,
and
what has any of this got to do with the hearing governance?
The only is confirming
the need I can remember the tension personally at the NCC in Paris at the start of March being really quite palpable. Framework was very clear to stop funds and resolve the interests of well-funded incumbents versus like newer but much poorer entrants. Had to push through upgrades, I mean, it's like a constant perennial problem, diversity and equal representation, and much more besides. So, it sounds nice, but on the surface, it's probably still a good deal.
Which is that all the critical policy you do is test your
how do you settle? In code? Because it's really how do you settle claims in code between parties who have valid arguments based in ethics and justice? We also submit the fact of human fallibility if we want to allow for greater growth and experimentation in the Ethereum ecosystem. A system that permits only infallibility is one that is incurable. In Latin, we already have forms of de facto governance. It just happens to be terrible. Here I refer to the strict tyranny of structuralists. There are people who have solutions. We will be managing an ever-increasing number of intersections between human practices and the underlying protocols. In other words, this problem of governance, both as directly related to the Ethereum right, but also our ecosystem, is set to explode. In this, I'm in complete agreement with
that.
And in that regard, by the way, thank you for all of
that.
Say this, which is given that blockchains will want to be and should be legal, we should abandon the mindset that the only acceptable changes to the protocol should be those that are required for the purpose of technical mainframeship.
Abandon
that. I think leaving aside the practical difficulties of trying to make a global protocol
How do they work? Well, there's no custodial operator.
Signing their name first on a petition.
So I triggered it here.
Because they could use their lives serious consequences for challenging Cohen, just like today. Just slightly different ways. So if they wanted to speak truth to power, they realized they had better design a new type of petition, so they designed this around Robin. The name is actually a bastardization of French for round Robin. I'm not going to say the French advertisement.
Well, that's okay.
See how they kind of sign their names in this sort of foot spokes on the wheel, right? You can't tell who's first. Regardless, really, no particular human is in charge.
Is it going to buy him
Spartacus or a letter for him to kind of circular protocol?
You
should. A level of anonymity for petition analysis. Nice.
But
let's think of community design for a while. Government systems.
And this overview of the paper of this, you get more than multiple.
Different community. And I'm talking about the people I thought instead. We should have done it to be like the force of nature, against which the power of states not only fails, but seems to fail in the most obvious fashion. As we have been earlier said this week, let's defend the A0. As Snowden implored, let's use Ethereum to export the whole values to every other part of the world, not the other way around. As I said, I speak today as a journalist, occasionally we take on power, versus the stories. So I really hope that these stories that I've told you give you some food for thought. That's not